Good morning.
There we go. Thank you, John. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Also with you.
What a beautiful day God has given to us that we're able to gather here together for worship, even during this time of the COVID-19 pandemic. We're glad to have you here this morning. We want to welcome everyone who is live streaming with us here this morning as well. We're glad to have you here. We have a wonderful service plan today. It is the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. You may know it better as Super Bowl 55. I don't think that's a liturgical term. But anyway, we're glad to have you here this morning, regardless of which team you're rooting for. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful day. We're in the season of Epiphany, and we're coming actually down towards the close. Next Sunday is going to be Transfiguration Sunday, and the close of the Epiphany season and the start of the Lenten season. Can you believe that? Lent is almost here. And during this time of Epiphany, Jesus reveals himself as who he is and what he came to do. Every miraculous act of Jesus pointed to his Father in heaven and why the reason why he was sent into this world. It was a foretaste of what was to come when sin and sorrow would no longer be a part of our broken world. Jesus' healings and his preaching and everything found its final culmination in the greatest miracle of all, and that was his suffering, death, and resurrection. And because of that, dear friends, we are healed by his forgiveness. His victory is our victory, and we have that healing of forgiveness of sins again here today, and he gives us hearts that are filled with hope and with assurance in him. We're glad to have you here this morning. Just a couple of quick announcements. The Lenten devotional booklets are available. They're back on the Welcome Center, I believe, out there on the Welcome Center. Be sure to pick a copy up as you leave this morning. They're free. They're provided by the Lutheran Hour Ministries. And they're just wonderful, wonderful devotions. I hope you'll take one and use it throughout the Lenten season. It begins a week from this coming Wednesday, so you still got a little time. We just want to make them available for everyone. But it started on Ash Wednesday. And Ash Wednesday is just around the corner for that reason. I'm going to do a special series this year called Places of the Passion. And it's going to begin on Ash Wednesday. We're going to meet that Wednesday night for service at 7 p.m. And then the worship committee felt that because of where COVID is still at, that we would not have the midweek services this year. And so we're going to be meeting on Sunday mornings, of course, and that's where I'll continue the series all the way up through Easter. Just to let you know, we have communion available today, our Lord's body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins, strengthening of our faith. We're also going to provide it for a drive-up communion after service. So just giving you a heads up, please feel free to go out on the grass, spend some time visiting with one another as you social distance and wear your masks. But just to let you know, cars will be coming up for the drive-up communion, so be careful as you cross the parking lot. Let's begin, shall we, with our opening sentences. I pray God's richest blessings on this time of worship for you. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth?
It is he who sets the house a circle in the earth, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain.
Have you not known? Have you not heard?
The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth.
He heals the brokenhearted
and binds up their wounds.
Great is our Lord and abundant in power.
His understanding is beyond measure.
Let us sing our opening hymn.
Thank you.
sins. Let us confess our sins to God and ask His forgiveness. Almighty God, Father, I confess to you that I daily sin against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. Some of my sins I know, and some remain unknown even to me. I have not loved you with my whole heart, and I have not loved my neighbor as I ought. By the power of your Spirit, make me aware of my sins and strengthen me to live as your child. For the sake of Jesus, forgive my sins.
Amen.
God is merciful. Before we were even aware of our need for forgiveness, God sent His Son to live under the law for us, to die in our place, and to rise again so that we might have forgiveness and life. As a called, ordained servant to Christ and by His authority, I therefore announce to you that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Life of trials, troubles, and temptations. Raise us up by your grace, that we be invigorated by your word and the hope affirmed through Christ's empty tomb. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 40. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been declared to you from the beginning? Have you not understood it from the founding of the earth? He is the one who sets above the circle of the earth. To him, its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a curtain, and he spreads them out like a tent to live in. He is the one who reduces dignitaries to nothing. He makes the judges of the world useless. They have hardly been planted. They have hardly been sown. Their stem has hardly taken root in the earth. Then he blows on them and they dry up. A driving storm carries them away like chaff. To whom can you compare me as if we were equals, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes to the heavens. See who created these things. See who brings out their army in great number and calls them all by name. Because of his great strength and mighty power, not one of them is missing. Why do you speak, O Jacob? O Israel, why do you say, my way is hidden from the Lord, and justice for me is ignored by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the eternal God. He is the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired, and he will not become weary. No one can find a limit to his understanding. He is the one who gives strength to the weak, and he increases the strength of those who lack power. Young men grow tired and become weary. Even strong men stumble and fall. But those who wait for the Lord will receive new strength. They will lift up their wings and soar like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not become tired. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. You see, if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast about, because an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I do this as a volunteer, I receive compensation, but if not, I have been entrusted with a responsibility as a steward. What then is my compensation? Present the gospel of Christ, free of charge when I preach it, instead of making use of the right I have when I preach the gospel. In fact, although I am free from all, I enslaved myself to all so that I might gain many more. To the Jews, I became like a Jew so that I might gain Jews. To those who are under the law, I became like a person under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might gain those who are under the law. To those who are without the law, I became like a person without the law, though I am not without God's law, but am within the law of Christ, so that I might gain those who are without the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might gain the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that I might save at least some. And I do everything for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share it along with others. Do you not know that when runners compete in the stadium, they all run, but only one receives a prize? Run like that, to win. Everybody who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable victor's wreath, but we do it for an imperishable. That is why there is nothing aimless about the way I run. There is no pummeling of the air in the way I box. Instead, I hit my body hard and make it my slave, so that after preaching to others, I myself will not be rejected. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Russ, so much for reading our first two readings this morning. Dear friends, let us now rise out of love, honor, and respect for our Lord and Savior and his word. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
This will also serve as a basis for the message this morning. They left the synagogue and went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was lying in bed, sick with a fever. Without delay, they told Jesus about her. He went to her, took her by the hand, and raised her up. The fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening, when the sun had set, the people kept bringing to him all who were sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door. He healed many people who were sick with various diseases and drove out many demons. But he did not allow the demons to speak because they knew who he was. Jesus got up early in the morning while it was still dark and went out. He withdrew to a solitary place and was praying there. Simon and his companions searched for him. And when they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." He told them, "Let's go somewhere else, to the neighboring villages, so that I can preach there too. In fact, that is why I have come." Then he went throughout the whole region of Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Living together in trust and hope in Christ Jesus, we confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated, dear friends, for the hymn of the day. Based off of the gospel reading which you just heard. Dear friends, straight from the synagogue, Jesus goes to the house of Simon and Andrew, along with James and John. He goes from demons to disease. And for Jesus, they are the same thing. Simon's mother-in-law is sick in bed with a fever. She hasn't been feeling well as of late. They told Jesus about her. Would you please look in on her, Lord? She'd really appreciate a visit from you. It seems almost trivial, doesn't it? Compared with the spectacular confrontation with the demon in the synagogue, this little incident seems minor in comparison, doesn't it? I mean, a fever? Serious, perhaps, but likely to pass in a few days. A 48-hour bug. Rest in bed, drink plenty of liquids, and take a couple of aspirins. Feed the cold, starve the fever. I'm sure she'll be back on her feet in no time. But nonetheless, Jesus responds, and he goes to her in that little moment of need. Sickness can be a very spiritual moment, a time of great insight, vulnerability, and dependence. Even with little flus and sniffles, we are reminded of our mortality. We are reminded that dust we are, right? And to dust we shall return. Our illnesses point also to a greater and more glorious day of resurrection, when these broken bodies of ours will rise to new life on that last day. And we will be transformed into bodies that are suited for eternal life. Sin and sickness go together. Perhaps not in the way that many people think or believe. We don't become sick because we have sinned. At least not necessarily. Yes, it's true, there are some sins that have intrinsic health effects. For example, drunkenness will cause a deterioration of one's health. Immorality and promiscuous sex do indeed bring dire health risks. All of this is true. But God isn't necessarily trying to tell you something when you catch a cold or the flu. Think of Job, good old Job, who suffered terribly. Not because he sinned, but because he was righteous. So we can't say that sin and sickness are linked in that way. Simon's mother-in-law was not necessarily sick with a fever because of any particular sin in her life. At least Jesus certainly doesn't mention anything. But sin and sickness have something in common. They are alien to us. They are foreign to our bodies. The result of bacteria and germs. Even our cancers are the result of our own cells turning against us and becoming a consumptive invader in our own bodies. That makes sickness and even things like demon possession pictures of sin. And sin is a spiritual COVID, a systemic virus, something that has invaded our humanity, and we can't seem to shake it no matter how hard we try. Sin is a disorder of God's order. It has taken over, resulting in a destructive chaos that brings death. Sin is inevitably a fatal disease for which the only cure is to die and rise in Jesus Christ. And so even that little case of the sniffles, even that little 48-hour fever, is a reminder that there is something wrong in our bodies, in our world, and in the cosmic order of things. And that, dear friends, is what Jesus comes to set right. Jesus comes to Simon's mother-in-law, this poor woman on her sickbed. And he comes to you in your time of weakness and sickness too. Never doubt that. He doesn't just come to you when you're healthy and thriving and feeling joy in your heart. He comes to you when you're down and weak and sick. The old Lutheran prayers for the sick used to speak of, quote, this time of your visitation. In other words, they viewed illness as a special time of God's visitation to us. And so Jesus comes to her. He doesn't say a word to her. Did you notice that? He simply takes hold of her hand and he lifts her up, and the fever just sort of melts away at his touch. That's a mini resurrection, by the way. Jesus reaches down, takes hold of our dead bodies, our dead hands, and he lifts us up. And we are healed, raised from the dead. That's what Jesus does. He lifts us from sin and death. He lifts us up from despair and shame and guilt. He lifts us up from all the things that would drag us down to our grave. You heard the prophet Isaiah this morning. Russ read his words. He, that is the Lord, is the one who gives strength to the weak, and he increases the strength of those who lack power. Young men grow tired and become weary. Even strong men stumble and fall. But those who wait for the Lord will receive new strength. They will lift up their wings and soar like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not become tired. When the Lord lifts you up, you don't just get up, you rise up to new life. And being lifted up, she begins to serve them. Did you notice that? Don't skip over that little detail. She begins to serve them. She puts out some tea and then sets out a little light lunch for them all. She goes back to the mundane chores of her life. But it isn't a day-to-day grind because she has been lifted up by the Lord Jesus. And now she lifts up her little sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. She offers herself as a living sacrifice and serves them in her vocation. And that holds true for you, dear friends, too. You are not lifted up to lie down, but rather to live under Christ in his kingdom and to serve him and others in his name. That's why we oftentimes end our services with the sending, right? I usually say, go in peace to serve the Lord. And you usually respond, thanks be to God. Someone once objected to that and said, that's the law, and we must never end on law. I think he wanted me to say something like this: the liturgy has ended, go in peace. Now, if I said that, you'd all shout, yippee, we're done. So let's take the rest of the day off. What's wrong with going in peace to serve the Lord? Isn't that what the new man in Christ wants to do? And isn't that what our old Adam needs to be told to do against its will? And isn't that what Simon's mother-in-law did? Why are we so afraid of that? We've been lifted up out of the condemnation of the law so that we might serve without fear of judgment. So yes, go in peace to serve the Lord. Go in that peace that you have received from him. Peter's mother-in-law served them. And Jesus served many more. That evening, as the sun was setting, the whole town showed up at the woman's front door. It's a good thing she was well, because she probably served them as well. The day started with a slight fever in bed, and it ended with a huge crowd on the front porch. And Jesus did what he always does. He healed the sick of all sorts of diseases, he cast out demons, and he silenced them just as he had done in the synagogue. You see, dear friends, the demons knew who he was and why he had come. They were eager to broadcast the secret before its time. They wanted Jesus to rise in popularity and then to circumvent the thing that they feared the most, his death. They knew that he had come to destroy the works of the devil by dying. They knew that all his healings and all his power over the demons, demon realm, came from the power of his cross. And they would do anything to keep him away from that cross, even serving up the untimely truth of who he was. Now, all Jesus had to do was to set up a healing center on the front porch, and Jesus could have wiped out disease across the Middle East. Simon's mother-in-law wouldn't have had to work again, by the way. The Pilgrims would have paid down her mortgage in no time. And in no short order, every ailment could have been wiped out. But notice Jesus didn't do that. No. Early the next morning, before sunrise, the Savior snuck out and went to a solitary place to pray. His disciples came looking for him to remind him that he had a waiting room full of patients. It was time to get back to the business of healing. But Jesus says something utterly remarkable to our ears. He says, "Let's go somewhere else, to the neighboring villages, so that I can preach there too. In fact, that is why I have come." Jesus did not come for popularity. He did not come to meet people's wants and needs completely, and that's what he did. He left all the sick and the suffering people behind in Capernaum, not to mention the demon-possessed and those nice little old ladies with their fevers and worse. He left them all behind for what? To go and preach. But couldn't Jesus have just sent his disciples out to do that? Healing diseases, casting out demons, and lifting little gray-haired ladies from their sick beds wasn't why Jesus came. He came, dear friends, to preach and to proclaim God's word. His miracles were signs that attested to his preaching. They showed that his words had the authority of God, with the power to heal and to silence the demons. His miracles weren't an end in themselves, but rather signs pointing to the word that he spoke, the word of life and peace and forgiveness. Simon's mother-in-law would fall ill again. Do you ever think about that? That wasn't her last illness, by the way. Jesus granted her no special immunity from sicknesses. One day she would indeed become ill again and at some point die. But she knew whom to trust. She knew the Savior would lift her up even from the grave. She knew that his word and his touch are the very word and touch of God himself and our humanity. Dear friends, think of every healing you experience, whether it be recovering from a cold or the flu or COVID or something far worse. Think of it as more than just dodging the bullet or getting a little favor from God. Think of it as a mini resurrection, a little instance of being lifted up by the hand of God. Think of it not as an end in itself, but rather as a sneak preview of a greater coming attraction. The very day when Jesus comes back to you and extends his hand and lifts your body from the grave to eternal life. When I pray with the sick, I always remind them that Jesus is the ultimate source of every healing, and that every prayer for healing finds its yes and its amen in Jesus Christ. Yes, you will be healed. Maybe not from this particular illness, and certainly not from dying. But dear friends, you will be healed. You will be lifted up, and you will be raised from the dead. And in the most important way, he lifts you up and heals you every time. Every time you hear those merciful words, "I forgive you. I forgive you. And every time you take his medicine of immortality and forgiveness, his very body and blood into your mouth. Again, here this morning. That's what Jesus came to do. And that's what Jesus does for you. So, go in peace to serve the Lord, but not in the second. Hold on, there's more to come. In his redeeming, touch, and healing name we pray. Amen. Let us sing. May your kingdom come among us, your humble servants. We thank you for the revelation of Jesus as Lord and Christ and as King forever. We pray that his dominion may be established from the rising to the setting of the sun. We praise you for sending us a king whose law is love, whose crown is truth, and whose scepter is righteousness. We pray that one day every nation, kindred, and tribe may confess that Jesus is Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let all the earth see that in him alone can healing be found for its wounds. Bear your holy arm, make those who spread violence among us know that you are a God whose laws must be obeyed. May your law and your justice prevail. Bring to naught the plans of those who seek to achieve their goals by taking the law into their own hands. Protect us from the violence of terrorists and others who seek to do us harm.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Because of our sins, we have no right to expect your divine consideration. But we come to you in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, your Son. By his merit, we ask your forgiveness and your mercy. Give comfort to those who mourn. Especially, Lord, do we pray for the family of Dave DeMarlier, his father, Merle, and for Crystal, Lord, and all the family at the loss of Dave's mother, Jo. We ask you, Lord, to be with them and to comfort them. You give patience also to the sick and the hospitalized, especially, Lord, for Ron Spott, our dear brother who suffers from strokes, from Olga Sullivan, Lord, who has so recently fell numerous times, for Judy Pinal, for Debbie, the sister of Dove, the man who delivers our flowers. And Lord, it so happens that Debbie is not one of your children. And we pray for her that she will come to know through her illness and through other ways in her life, through Christians walking across her path, that Jesus loves her, that he is her Savior as well. We pray for Jim. We pray for Callie Power, Lord. She's going through some difficulties in her pregnancy. Be with her and protect her and the beautiful child that you have created in her womb. We pray for Tom Martins as he undergoes chemo and radiation. I pray for my brother Alan as he continues to recover from heart surgery. My cousin Barry Tucker, also, Lord, recovering from heart surgery. For Ryan Draper, for Shanna's eyes, for Ron Clevenger, for Sylvia Lang, for John Steely, for Carolyn Carnahan, for Juan Chacon and Tony Sullivan, and Martha Neal and Diana Holquitt and James Goldsmith, and Lord, the list goes on of those loved ones who are dear, near and dear to our hearts, and those that we carry silently within our hearts. We ask your healing touch be upon them too. And for all those, Lord, who continue to battle COVID pandemic, we pray, Lord, that with the vaccines and with the different processes that we put into place, that this COVID can be a thing of the past, Lord, and that it once again will leave and allow us to restore ourselves back to some normalcy. Lord, we pray, give strength to the weak and abundance to the needy. Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we also thank you for the many blessings that you give to us in our personal lives, in our families, in our church, in our country. Heavenly Father, please protect our nation, our military, and our leaders. Turn our nation's hearts towards you, Holy Father, that we may put you first and obey your commandments, that we may not be lukewarm in our lifestyles, but rather stand courageously and confidently in your most holy and precious word. We pray that we may acknowledge you always in our daily lives and glorify you with all that we say and do. We pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen.
Streaming, now is the darkness.
Comes to us in with and under this bread and the wine with this very body and blood. Blessed are you, Almighty God, as you come to your people who are weary and faint, as you promise to give strength as on eagle's wings. In your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, you have given us the strength to face our days until the unending days of your glory to come. As we celebrate together what you give for our spiritual healing, in with and under the bread and wine is the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Use this means of grace to strengthen our trust in all your promises. Receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, dear Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
You may be seated, dear friends. Thank you. body given on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Mike, take heed. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given for you. Child, these invite you to take heed of his true body given on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins. Take heed of the true body of Christ given for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Lord be with you always and keep you in your baptismal grace. He loved you very, very much. We belong to you. Tim, take heed of the true body of Christ given upon the cross for the forgiveness of all your sins.
Thank you. dead body of Christ.
Strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Amen.
Dear friends, God be with you all. Have a wonderful day. Enjoy the beautiful day that God has given to you. Remember that you have been healed and that you are called to serve those around you. Have a wonderful day, and regardless of who wins the Super Bowl. The Lord who made heaven and earth bless you and keep you. The Lord who stopped nothing to save you, make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord, whose glory it is always to show love and mercy, look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God bless you all. Have a wonderful week. Please be seated, if you would, and you'll be escorted.